Do we want to live in a world where big corporations can make most of the political and public health decisions, or do we want to live in a world where people make those decisions in their own interest?
Onze levensverwachting is nog nooit zo hoog geweest. Maar ook het aantal mensen niet dat onnodig sterft ten gevolge van slecht voedsel, tabak, alcohol, wapens in het verkeer en medicijnen. En de Amerikaanse hoogleraar Nicholas Freudenberg wijst vooral richting het bedrijfsleven in dit boek. Legaal, maar fataal. Professor Freudenberg, this book is about few hundred companies which produce perfectly legal products. So what is the problem?
So I think the problem is these legal products have become the major causes of premature death and preventable illness in the world today. And the products are imposing illness, pain, suffering on individuals and their families, but also causing taxpayers to spend money on healthcare, reducing the productivity of the workforce. And so I think as a society, we have to ask, do we want to allow these companies to continue to market and distribute these products, often without any regulation at all?
Products we take, why are the companies to blame?
Well, I think these companies have worked very hard to make their products attractive. And what they say is, well, people want our products. But I think what the case I make in the book is that they have created the market for those products. They have studied the decisions that people make even before the rational mind. Appeal of sugar, fat, and salt based on our deepest biological instincts. The notion that leads some people to buy sports utility vehicles, that they want to be safer, that they want to be protected, that they want to be more manly. And so I think these companies that have produced products that have contributed so much to premature death and preventable illness are externalizing, a term that economists sometimes use, the costs to society as a whole. And I think we need to look to return those costs to the makers, who are, after all, profiting mightily from these products.
The companies produce goods which we can't refuse?
What they claim is that people are choosing this, but I think they've manufactured that desire for them, and that it does not seem rational that it should be legal to create products and market them to children that will lead those children to have preventable illnesses and premature deaths. I think as a society we have to ask, are we willing to accept that it's okay to make money by aggressively promoting products that contribute to obesity, diabetes, and other diseases?
We consumers don't have a free choice to neglect certain products or to accept it or to buy it.
Right. I think what I would say is there's a continuum of choice, and if individuals have a responsibility for what they consume, and I believe they do, then I think society and corporations also have a responsibility for what they produce and how they market it. And basically, I think the responsibility for setting the ground rules lies with government. I think it's the public's job to say, you can sell this, but not that. You can market this way, but not that way. And I think everybody agrees with that. I mean, very few people say that, for example, anyone should be able to sell heroin to anyone they want anywhere. And what we disagree about is who should set the rules and where do we draw the line. And I think in the last 50 years or so, we've moved the line steadily to one side, to the corporate side. And that has produced a set of problems for our society, for our taxpayers, for the government, and we need to be rethinking where we want to draw that line.
Okay, let's look at some products. Tobacco, in the first place. Everybody in the world knows tobacco is a bad habit, bad for your health. It could be very hard to quit smoking.
But with it's an addictive substance.
Exactly, nicotine. But with the knowledge we have now, it is quite stupid to start smoking these days.
So a lot of people started before that knowledge was widespread, and now I think The current debates are around e-cigarettes, which are nicotine delivery products in the United States. More young people are now trying e-cigarettes than tobacco. We've been successful in getting the message across that tobacco is harmful, but these same companies are now marketing nicotine in a different form. What they say is it's a tool for people who are smoking to quit, but in actuality, their biggest market is young people and never smokers. And that seems wrong to me, to deliver an addictive product that we know is associated with health problems to young people. And I don't think that that should be legal.
The e-cigarette doesn't work to quit smoking, you say?
It helps some people who are smokers to quit. It has mixed things. But the largest consumers, and if you look at where the marketing is directed, is at young people who are not smokers. And so the fear of public health people is that it will be a gateway drug. It will be the starting point, and then later they'll turn to tobacco. Or they'll simply stay with nicotine, which is itself a health-threatening product.
Drinking, alcohol, same problem?
Yes, and I think the alcohol industry has been on a very concerted campaign to make people think drinking is healthy. And in the case of alcohol and tobacco, for that matter, I don't think the goal is prohibition. I think the goal is to make healthy choices easy choices. And instead, what public policy has been doing is to make it easy for people to eat unhealthy food. In fact, unhealthy food is cheaper. Is easier to find. Tobacco outlets are everywhere. Alcohol outlets are everywhere. And so I think we want public policies that make healthy choices easy choices and that make unhealthy choices less easy.
Let's look at nutrition. Mm-hmm. Food. Obesity is a very big problem.
Yes.
Why are some people too much, too big, and you're not?
Mm-hmm. I think from a public health perspective, in order to understand obesity, we need to look at population levels. And there have always been some people who were obese and some who were thin, like you and I are. But I think what is unprecedented in human history is when a third of the population, a half the population, two-thirds of the population becomes obese. And there's no plausible biological explanation. There's no plausible explanation that could say suddenly the willpower of individuals has changed. So then we ask, well, what has changed? And I think what has changed is the food environment. And the global food companies, Nestle, Unilever, Kellogg, have saturated our markets with foods that are high in fat, salt, sugar, the very foods that are contributing to obesity, diabetes, heart disease, and put those products within hand's reach of almost everyone in the world.
Do you look at products if they have sugar?
I do. And some people do and some people don't. And the food industry has been opposing regulations that require sugar labeling and that require warning. Yeah. If truly they wanted people to be informed, they would put those labels. But they're opposed because I think they don't want people to make informed decisions because those decisions might be less profitable for their products.
Okay, but let's go back for a while, for a moment, from the big companies to the individual.
Mm-hmm.
You say you look at the products if there's sugar in it. That is something we can all do.
Mm-hmm.
Also, the people with too much weight. So why do you look at the products and they don't? Do they have a different choice than you have?
I think I would reframe the question, what's the most effective way of improving the health of the population? And I believe that developing a strategy that requires changing the habits and perceptions of the 8 billion people of the world,
yeah.
It's a little bit like Sisyphus. You know, you're asking us to roll a rock up a hill.
Yeah.
Much easier to reduce the amount of sugar or salt in food. It's not like people voted to have high sugar food or high salt food. The food companies decided they could make more profits by putting more of those ingredients to make them more palatable, to make them what some people call hyper palatable.
Yeah.
So I think I would rather have health officials deciding how much salt and sugar to put in food than companies, because then the decisions would be based on improving population health, public health, and not on what would be most profitable for the food company.
Okay, but if we all look at the products for sugar, for salt, and we all say no, then the companies should reduce the
yes,
sugar amount.
And it's interesting to ask why that hasn't happened, despite the fact that we've been educating about salt and sugar for 20, 30 years. And I think the fact it hasn't happened can be explained by two things. One, how hard it is to change habits once they've become established, and salt and sugar are products that we've been biologically evolved to have a craving for, you know, for 10,000 years. And when we lived in the Kalahari Desert, it wasn't a problem because there wasn't a lot of salt and sugar around. But when Nestle and Unilever and Kellogg put all that sugar in the reach of every person, then it's easy to get too much. And then you have obesity, and then you have diabetes.
You blame the drug companies for the high profits, for the high prices of medicines.
Yes.
But profit usually is a great force to develop medicines. Do you recognize that?
I think we need to look at where profit is a satisfactory motive to develop new drugs and get them out to people, and where it doesn't seem to have worked so well. I think there was a report just last week by Goldman Sachs called the Genomic Revolution, the Genome Revolution. And increasingly, drug companies are finding it's not profitable to develop cures for illnesses, because once you cure a disease, the market is over. And what is profitable is developing treatments that require daily or weekly administration for the life of the patient. And so we have we run the risk that the big drug companies will now be abandoning cures for drugs that continue to be major global health problems, hepatitis C, for example, and instead choosing to concentrate on developing drugs that will maintain people's health but require spending 100 euros a week or 100 euros a day in order to maintain that treatment. So I would say, again, in a decent society, those decisions shouldn't be made based on profit. They should be based on what will be good for the largest proportion of people.
So you're a professor.
Yes.
But also a political activist.
Yes.
From the left, I guess.
Yes, I mean, I think protecting public health is a broad goal, but yes.
So your idea is to break the power and the impact of the big companies.
Yes, I think there's been, over the last 40 or 50 years, a very significant transfer of power from the public and civil society to corporations. And I think they've abused that growing power to act in their own private interest at the expense of the public interest. And I think that is threatening the world in some very important ways. And therefore, we need public policies, we need elected officials who can return to the public the power needed to protect public health.
So it's a very interesting book, this one. I learned from it. What I miss is the responsibility of the consumers themselves.
Mm-hmm. I do say I think individuals have responsibility, and I do believe that. But I think we hear a lot about individual and consumer responsibility. We hear it in the media, we hear it from business. They promote that message, I think, relentlessly. And so I think we need to balance that message with corporate responsibility. And I wanted to emphasize what I think has been the message that's been left out of the public debate. If we ask individuals to be responsible, then we also have to ask corporations to be responsible. And there are things that they have control of, that they are responsible for. There are things that individuals have control of, and they're responsible for. And I think it all gets down to, what kind of a world do we want to live in? You know, do we want to live in a world where big corporations can make most of the political and public health decisions? Or do we want to live in a world where people make those decisions in their own interest? And for me, the answer is clear.
Thank you very much.